Let us worship God, joining our voices together in singing Psalm 101:38, all four verses, or at least the first four verses, singing to the praise of God. The tune is Winchester 148. The words are those of Psalm 138, 1 through 4. Thee will I praise with all my heart. I will sing praises to thee before the gods, and worship will toward the sanctuary. I'll praise thy name even for thy truth and kindness of thy love, for thy word hast magnified all thy great name above. So let us sing this Psalm 148. Let us unite our hearts together before the Lord in prayer, standing as we pray. I will bless thee, O Lord, at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. O Lord, it is time, we pray, for thee to work and to bring repentance. We are in such a nation as was Israel of old. And we would ask the question, where is repentance in the churches in this sinful age and in this sinful land? And temporal judgments have begun to fall upon us as warnings of the impending and greater and final judgment that will be both temporal and eternal. There are wars and rumors of wars. Murders abound in the land. Murders by children as well as by adults. Yes, and even the most defenseless and helpless of all human beings, the unborn children are slaughtered by thousands in the land. fill the land with their blood, we have. And there is no repentance. Very little in the church even, much less outside the church. And evil is called good, and good evil. Unrighteousness is called righteousness, and wickedness is called virtue. The wicked perversion of men with men is promoted as right and good, to be commended even by those in the highest stations of this land with the greatest civil authority. But it is not so. Indeed, it is an abomination, as you have called it. And an abomination such as is unseemly, reprehensible, twisted, perverted. Save us, Lord, before we go down into destruction. Take us, O Lord, and cause us, even from the highest in this land, to those in the grassroots, to repent. You can do it, O God. In heaven, we pray you would, and keep us from the disease and the dreadful destruction that is coming now upon this land at this time. May we awake and remember from whence we've fallen. Remember and repent and do the first works. For it will soon be written, too late, too late. These things are all an abomination in thy sight, and may they be seen and understood by us to be the ungodly abomination that they indeed are in your sight. Father, we do pray for the mission of the church. We are grateful that there is that ongoing task, and this congregation is a part of it, not only by the preaching here in this place, but by the witness that they give in this community through the open-air preaching. And we pray for the success of mission of the church across the land, indeed in every place of this land, where there are chapels and outposts and churches. And we pray also in the denomination of which this congregation is a part, that you would cause it to flourish and bless it, and the witness to go forth throughout the denomination and the other places where there are such congregations of yourself. We pray for that mission of the church to go forward in distant lands, far removed from where we are, remote places of the earth, where we little think sometimes that there are churches, but there are. And we're grateful for that which you are doing through the missionaries of this congregation, of this church and congregation as well. You would cause them to flourish and to be protected by your divine providence from the harm that would come to them, from those who hate the gospel, who hate God, who exalt the idols and would lift up the idolatry. We pray, Father, we would not be a part of that and become immersed in the idolatry of this land, in the Baals that go forward. We do not even recognize them. They're such a part of the culture. We don't seem to recognize that they are Baals in this land to which we bow down and serve and give our allegiance. Deliver us from such idolatry. Make us aware of what we're doing, that we would no longer continue in this strand, in this vein, in this perversion, in this idolatry. Father, we thank you for the minister of this congregation and ask your blessings upon him as a person. You would cause him to know more and more of the word that you would deliver to these, your people, in this congregation. Let him know it now as he preaches in the afternoon where you've called him this day. May that service be a flourishing testimony of your goodness and of your mercy and of your grace. If you're pleased to make it so, make it a powerful instrument Send revival to that place in Atlanta, but send it here in this place also. You might be glorified and served. And we pray that you would bless the servant that you have put over the flock and the elders as well. May they know more and more the mind of Christ and understand what his will is for this, your congregation, and lead them in that right way. Not against it, but in the light of it, may they walk with you and trust in you and give thanks and thanks again for all that you've given to them. And may they honor you by the way in which they live and show forth your praises. In every way, may they serve you, even in the Sabbath day. Father, we pray that you would give us understanding of what it is that we can do to please you. And may we do what is well-pleasing in your sight in the keeping of a Sabbath day. Not with rigor and legalism, but with very careful approach that we would walk with you and love you and therefore do what is pleasing in your sight. Not our wills, not our pleasure, not our delight. And yet it will become our delight more and more as we learn to delight in you and in your law and in your customs and in your Sabbath day. May we learn it quickly. But if not, be patient, Father, to teach us that eventually we might gain that understanding, knowledge, faith, and love of what you love, and reverence for what you reverence, and obedience to what you have asked. We pray that this would be a time of rejoicing in everyone's heart, that the word of God is proclaimed, and we can learn it, and may you teach us from it, instruct us out of it, carefully, thoughtfully, prayerfully, believingly instruct us that the servants that you have placed over this congregation would be obeyed and submitted to with all love and reverence, with all faith. We ask this, that the church might in this place grow and flourish and abound in good works, not to earn salvation, nor in any way to merit your grace. That is unmerited, undeserved. And yet, because we are the recipients of your mercy and grace, undeserved and unmerited, and because that by faith, which is a gift from your Holy Spirit, we have come to believe, we would be filled with gratitude for your grace, for your love, for your justification, for your acquittal of all our sins. And we would in thankfulness and in love abound in good works, showing forth the praises of him who called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. Father, we do again pray for those who are sick, troubled, grieved. We ask that you would comfort, strengthen, and that where there is infirmity, you might take from those weak limbs the weakness that has been so long with them and add your strength that they might indeed serve you with a greater vigor and a greater measure of confidence in the Lord Jesus Christ. But if not, make them patient to suffer weakness and the plight that is theirs and the afflictions that accompany life in this world. But may they pray and serve you with all the strength that you will give them. All for your glory we ask it. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Singing again, Psalm 115, verses 10 through 18. And this tune is Soli, number 129. But the psalm is 115, excuse me, verses 10 through 18. Oh, blessed are ye of the Lord who have made the earth and heaven. The heaven, even heavens, are God's, but he, earth, to men's sons hath given. The dead, nor who in silence go, God's praise do not record. But henceforth we forever will bless God. Praise ye the Lord. Psalm 115, beginning at verse 10. Reading give your reverent attention to the reading of God's holy word found in this chapter 34 of the book of Exodus. And the Lord said unto Moses, hew two tables of stone like unto the first, and I will write upon these tables the words that were in the first tables, which thou breakest. And be ready in the morning, and come up in the morning unto Mount Sinai, and present thyself there to me in the top of the mount. For no man shall come up with thee, neither let any man be seen throughout all the mount, neither let the flocks nor herds feed before that mount. And he hewed out two tables of stone like unto the first, and Moses rose up early in the morning and went up into Mount Sinai as the Lord had commanded him, and took in his hand the two tables of stone. And the Lord descended in the cloud and stood with him there and proclaimed the name of the Lord. And the Lord passed by before him and proclaimed, the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, and that will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children, unto the children's children, unto the third and fourth generation. And Moses made haste and bowed his head toward the earth and worshiped. And he said, if now I have found grace in thy sight, O Lord, let my Lord, I pray thee, go among us, for it is a stiff-necked people, and pardon our iniquities and sin, and take us for thine inheritance or heritage. And he said, behold, I make a covenant. Before all thy people I will do marvels, such as have not been done in all the earth, nor in any nation, and all the people among which thou shalt see the work of the Lord. For it is a terrible thing that I will do with you. Observe thou that which I command thee this day. Behold, I drive out before you the Amorite and the Canaanite and the Hittite and the Perizzite and the Hivite and the Jebusite. Take heed to thyself, lest thou make a covenant with the inhabitants of the land whither thou goest, lest it be for a snare in the midst of thee. But ye shall destroy their altars, break their images, and cut down their groves. For the Lord shall worship, for thou shalt worship no other God. For the Lord, whose name is jealous, is a jealous God. Lest thou make a covenant with the inhabitants of the land, and they go a-whoring after their gods, and do sacrifice unto their gods, and one call unto thee, and thou eat of his sacrifice, and thou take of the daughters of thy, take of their daughters unto thy sons, and their daughters go a-whoring after their gods, and make thy sons to go a-whoring after their gods, and thou shalt make no molten image or molten gods. The feast of unleavened bread thou shalt keep. 7 days shalt thou eat unleavened bread, and as I have commanded thee, in the time of the month Abib, and in the month Abib thou camest out of Egypt. All that openeth the matrix is mine, and every firstling among thy cattle, whether ox or sheep, that is male. But the firstling of an ass thou shalt redeem with a lamb. And if thou redeem him not, then thou shalt break his neck. All the firstborn of thy sons shalt thou redeem, and none shall appear before me empty. 6 days shalt thou work, but on the seventh day thou shalt rest, in the earing time and in the harvest time thou shalt rest. And thou shalt observe the feast of weeks, and the first fruits of wheat and harvest, and the feast of ingathering at the year's end. Thrice in the year shall all thy men children appear before the Lord God, the God of Israel. For I will cast out the nations before thee, and enlarge thy borders. Neither shall any man desire thy land, when thou shalt go up to appear before the Lord thy God, thrice in the year. Thou shalt not offer the blood of my sacrifice with leaven, neither shall the sacrifice of the feast of the Passover be left unto the morning. The first of the first fruits of thy land thou shalt bring unto the house of the Lord thy God. Thou shalt not see the kid in his mother's milk. And the Lord said unto Moses, write thou these words, For after the tenor of these words, I have made a covenant with thee and with Israel. And he was there with the Lord 40 days and 40 nights. And he did neither eat bread nor drink water. And he wrote upon the tables the words of the covenant, the Ten Commandments. Came to pass when Moses came down from Mount Sinai with the two tables of testimony in Moses' hand, when he came down from the mount, that Moses wist not that the skin of his face shone while he talked with them. And when Aaron and all the children of Israel saw Moses' face, behold, the skin of his face shone, and they were afraid to come nigh him. And Moses called unto them, and Aaron and all the rulers of the congregation returned unto him, and Moses talked with them. And afterward all the children of Israel came nigh, and he gave them a commandment, all that the Lord hath spoken with him in Mount Sinai. And till Moses had done speaking with them, he put a veil over his face. But when Moses went in before the Lord to speak with him, he took the veil off until he came out. And he came out and spake unto the children of Israel that which was commanded. And the children of Israel saw the face of Moses, that the skin of Moses' face shone. And Moses put the veil upon his face again till he went in to speak with him. God bless the reading and hearing of his own holy word. Let us sing to the praise of God. The hymn is 116, verses 1 through 8, Psalm, and the tune is Cunningham, number 48. The words are those of Psalm 116, 1 through 8. I love the Lord because my voice and prayer he did hear. Do you love him because he hears prayer? He is a prayer hearing and a prayer answering God, and he never fails to hear the cry and the prayers of his people. Singing Psalm 116.
I will live with God.
Looking again into God's word, turn to Acts, the 20th chapter. Give your attention to this, the reading of God's own word. And after the uproar was ceased, Paul called unto him the disciples and embraced them and departed for to go into Macedonia. And when he had gone over those parts and had given them much exhortation, he came into Greece. And there abode 3 months. And when the Jews lay wait for him as he was about to sail unto Syria, he purposed to return through Macedonia. And there accompanied him into Asia Sopater of Berea, and of the Thessalonians Aristarchus and Synctus, and Gaius of Derbe, and Timotheus, and of Asia Tychicus and Trophimus. These going before tarried for us at Troas. And we sailed away from Philippi after the days of unleavened bread, and came unto them of Troas in 5 days, where we abode 7 days. And upon the first day of the week, when the disciples were come together to break bread, the custom, of course, that they would worship on the first day of the week, Paul preached unto them, ready to depart for the morrow, and continued his speech until midnight. And there were many lights in the upper chamber where they were gathered together. And there sat in a window a certain young man named Eutychus, being fallen into a deep sleep. And as Paul was long preaching, he sunk down with sleep and fell down from the third loft and was taken up dead. And Paul went down and fell upon him and embracing him said, trouble not yourselves, for his life is in him. When he therefore was come up again and had broken bread and eaten and talked a long while, even till break of day, so he departed. And they brought the young man alive and were not a little comforted. And they went before to ship. They went before to ship and sailed unto Assos, and were there intending to take in Paul, for so he had appointed, and minding himself to go afoot. And when he met with us at Assos, we took him in and came to Mytilene. I'm stumbling here. And we sailed thence and came the next day to Christos, and the next day arrived at Samos, and tarried at Trogyllium, and the next day we came to Miletus, for Paul had determined to sail by Ephesus, because he would not spend the time in Asia, for he hasted, if it were possible for him, to be at Jerusalem at the day of Pentecost. And from Miletus he sent to Ephesus, and he called the elders of the church. And when they were come to him, he said unto them, ye know from the first day that I came into Asia, after what manner I have been with you at all seasons, serving the Lord with all humility of mind, and with many tears and temptations, and which befell me by the lying in wait of the Jews, and how I kept back nothing that was profitable for you, but have showed you and have taught you publicly and from house to house, testifying both to the Jews, also to the Greeks, repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. And now, behold, I go in the Spirit unto Jerusalem, not knowing the things that shall befall me, save that the Holy Ghost witnesses in every city, saying that bonds and afflictions abide you. But none of these things move me, neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course with joy, and the ministry which I have received of the Lord Jesus to testify the gospel of the grace of God. And now, behold, I know that ye all, among whom I have gone preaching the kingdom of God, shall see my face no more. Wherefore I take you to record this day that I am pure from the blood of all men. For I have not shunned to declare unto you all the counsel of God. Take heed, therefore, unto yourselves and to the flock over the which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers, to feed the church of God which he hath purchased with his own blood. For I know this, that after my departing shall grievous wolves enter in among you, not sparing the flock. Also of your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things, to draw away disciples after them. Therefore watch and remember that by the space of 3 years I ceased not to warn everyone night and day with tears. And now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you an inheritance among all them that are sanctified. I have coveted no man's silver or gold or apparel. Yea, ye yourselves know that these hands have ministered unto my necessities and to them that were with me. I have showed you all things, how that so laboring ye ought to support the weak and to remember the words of the Lord Jesus, how he said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. And when he had spoken, he kneeled down. And prayed with them all. And they all wept sore and fell on Paul's neck and kissed him, sorrowing most of all for the words which he spake, that they should see his face no more. And they accompanied him unto the ship. Sacrifices of gospel worship are our duty to God. We saw and read of that this very morning. By him, Christ, therefore let us offer the sacrifice of praise to God. Continually, that is the fruit of our lips, giving thanks in his name. Sacrifices of Christian fellowship or service are our duty to men, generally, to do good to them, as we also saw this morning. But to do good and to communicate, or koinonia, a huge Greek word. It's hard to translate. It has so many meanings. To share, maybe one of the best meanings here, but to do good and to share, forget not. For with such sacrifices, God is well pleased. So there's the sacrifice of this worship of God. There's the sacrifice that involves our giving and helping others. And they're all the worship of God in one way. Doing good. And this is well-pleasing to God. All of this kind of sacrificial worship is well-pleasing to God. But now we look this afternoon at obedience and submission are the duty that we owe to church rulers or leaders. And I read that from verse 14, 17. Obey them that have the rule over you and submit yourselves, for they watch for your souls as they that must give an account, that they may do so with joy and not with grief. For that is unprofitable for you. So what is it that we're talking about? The relationship of the people with their leaders or their rulers. Now we might think that this is civil, and it could be, because we do owe obedience and reverence to civil rulers. And it may be also in Paul's mind, or the writer's mind here. We're not told who the author of this letter is. But it is certainly primarily to the church rulers and leaders. So the relationship of the people to their rulers is neither lawless nor slavish. It is not rebellion, nor is it dependence. It is obedience and honor and reverence and submission. Obedience and honor are given by us to the church rulers, the rulers who truly seek the eternal salvation of us, his own people. If we would not hear, if we would not honor, if we will not obey, if we will not submit to our rulers, be warned, be counseled. There are consequences, and the consequences are not small. They are dreadful. So let us think first of all about the duty. Secondly, the reason, or the motive, we might call it, for the duty. The duty is prescribed in the 17th verse. Obey them that have the rule over you and submit yourselves, for they watch for your souls. We're getting now into the reason or motive. But it is to obey and to submit. Now, to whom this duty is due? To whom are we to give the duty? Who are they? They're the rulers. Now, you must notice, this is not the first time that this subject has come up in this epistle. Not even in this chapter. In fact, it's all the way through here in some ways. But I go back at least to verse 7. Remember them which have the rule over you, who have spoken unto you the word of God, whose faith follow, considering the end of their conversation. Christ the same, yesterday, today, and forever. These are now another group of rulers, it seems. The first have passed from the scene. The leaders of the church that they started with are no longer with them. They probably died, more than likely. Now there is a new group of leaders or rulers, and they must honor them and submit to them and obey them. The new rulers have come into their place, and they had remembered, I trust, they're called to remember them, the rulers that are now no longer there. and they are now being called to obedience and submission to the new rulers, to those who come in their place. And this duty is addressed to those, second group. It's not just gifts, you see, it's office. And the office demands obedience and submission. The first group may have had greater gifts than the second, we're not told. But all of them, every one of them, is in the office of ruler or leader and must be given obedience and submission. Now, them that have the rule over you, who are they? Those that have the rule over you. It's all one word in the Greek. Them that have the rule over you is one word. It means guides. It means governors. Because you see, men are blind and they need guides to lead them. And they're stubborn. And they need governors to direct them. And this is done by what? By the rulers. They are guides and governors for the blind and for the rebellious. And they're to lead them how? This is important. By what they do, by what they say, by their preaching and teaching, and by their example. Saying the right things and also doing the right things. These guides are the elders of the church, most likely. So there is a plurality of elders. More than one. In every church in the New Testament, they are elders, plural. And there are two kinds of elders, according to 1 Timothy 5:17. I don't want to make too much of this, but I think it is important to at least note that there are the two kinds of elders. 1 Timothy 5:17. Let the elders that rule well be counted worthy of double honor, especially they who labor in the word and doctrine. Those who rule and those who labor also. They rule as well, but they also labor in the word and doctrine. Now, whether you call them teaching elders or whether you call them just elders, whether you call them ministers or teaching elders, whatever terms you use, it's clear they are two different kinds of elders within the church. Two classes, one office. Only one office, elder. And yet they seem to have these two classifications, these two classes. Those who rule only, or primarily, but those who rule and teach, and who rule by their teaching. So their authority is in, what would we say? It is not rigid authoritarianism. They lead by reasoning with the people, by the moral force of their example. So they lead them, they do not drive them. Those in church office are there by God's authority, and they stand in His place, and they have the authority of God Himself as God's representatives, as God's ambassadors, as God's under-shepherds. Christ being the chief shepherd, they being under-shepherds. So they do not constrain them. They do not force them, but they lead by reasoning, teaching, and by example, showing and walking with them, ahead of them perhaps, to guide them, to govern them. So the twofold duty to be fulfilled by those who guide and govern. So we have who it is, the rulers, leaders. Then we have the duty. We have to know who's to do the duty. And so we've dealt with that to some extent. Now we look at the duty itself. They are to obey. Literally in the Greek, and I don't like to do so much Greek, but these words are very large and very important. Be persuaded of a thing is the idea that's given here in the word in the original. Be persuaded of a thing. So when persuaded in mind and in heart, then they come to believe in the will. And then they obey and consent. When the power of the Holy Spirit is given, then they will, as it were, obey and submit. Because they are, first of all, persuaded of the thing. That's the word obedience, or obey. Second, submit. At the first, this may seem a repetitious thing. It's not. Submission has more to do with the spirit or the attitude in which one believes and obeys. In other words, there's respect and honor. So we are to believe and obey those in authority, and we're to do it with respect and honor to those rulers. If they are dishonorable and wicked rulers, we cannot follow them nor accept their wicked instruction. We struggle to do so, but we're still to obey their lawful commands because they are in office and placed there as God has put them in those offices. But these rulers are worthy. These rulers are deserving of their respect and their honor. They're not rulers in name only. Yes, they are elders, but they are true elders, elders indeed. Now, when our church leaders discharge their office in line with God's word, we are to give them all faith and reverence and honor. We're to obey them even sometimes when they disappoint us and may walk in the wrong way or show us the wrong example. Don't do what they do. Do what they teach you to do, if it's a lawful command from God. This is the best means of our being built up in the church and of the church coming into purity and peace and unity in the faith. So, do we wish to build the church? This is the way to do it. Now, the ordinary guides appointed by God are not so exciting sometimes as those innovative preachers on the television, radios, campaigns, internet. I don't know where you listen, but your rulers may not be so exciting as these. But do they watch for your soul? Do those leaders or speakers that you get from the television, from the radio, from the internet, from other ways, do they watch for your soul? That's what you need, someone to watch for your souls. Yes, we kind of like the splash and the glamour, but do they watch for your souls? Are they faithful and God appointed? Are they shepherds of the sheep? Not for themselves, but for the sheep. They often fleece the sheep. Maybe you don't know what I mean. They take the wool and don't care for the sheep. Get the money where the crop is, or well, not the crop, but where the finances are profitable. And then they leave the sheep to fend for themselves without a guide, without someone to guard them, with no one to take care of them and govern them. There are too many like this, tens of thousands of these kinds of people. And people love to follow them over the television. Oh my, how these ministers abound. And you can find them if you're looking for them. What we need are ministers, rulers, who watch for the sheep. And to them we yield obedience and submission, because they're called of God and faithful and under shepherds, as it were. So we have looked at the duty, who's to do it and what it is. We look now at the ground, or the reason, or the motive is perhaps the best way of doing the prescribed duty that's given us. They watch for your souls as they that must give an account. So they watch for your souls. Your everlasting soul salvation is the object of their attention. And they wish to gain your salvation. And so they watch. I read from Calvin again, without apology. The office of bishop, that is, of elder, which is the same, overseer is the word, bishop. The office of bishop is such that it includes the greatest labors. Listen carefully, because every word, Calvin seems to have a weight with, every word has weight. Includes the greatest labors as well as the utmost danger, so that if we want to be thankful, it is scarcely possible to repay what we owe to them, to the rulers. Moreover, since they must give an account of us to God, it would be a disgrace if they were held no account by us. He goes on to remind us how much their concern benefits us. If the salvation of our souls is precious to us who watch over it, it will be by no means worthless. So, because they have this watchful care of our soul's salvation, then their care will not be worthless. So he commands them to be willing and able to obey, so that our pastors may also gladly and joyfully do what is necessary for their duties. And he goes on to give much more than I am able to give you at this time. So the word watch is a wakeful, tireless, constant care. When you're watching, are you awake? Of course you are. You don't want sleep on the watch. If you do, you're to be blamed. And what happens when you have someone watching? They're awake, first of all. Then they're tireless. And then they're constant in their care. So this stands for the entire duty, the whole duty of the office of elder, that they be watchful. They can watch in prayer, they can watch in preaching, they can watch in teaching, they can watch in catechizing, they can watch in visiting over the sheep, in warning the sheep, in seeking the fruit of the preached word, as they labor to see such fruit brought forth by the Spirit of God. Only God can bring the fruit. But they must watch for the fruit and look for the fruit of the preached word in the lives of the sheep. So there is discipline involved. And discipline involves admitting someone to the church. First of all, it begins when the elders, the rulers, admit you to membership in the church. And then it may involve discipline by reclaiming stray sheep who wander away, who seem to desert, who do not stay where they should stay and walk as they should walk and do what they should do and say what they should say. As a nurse watches the child, but especially the sick child, day and night, the nurse watches the sick child. So the elders, the minister, is to watch over the church members. As a shepherd watches over the flock by night, so the elders watch, protect, and defend the flock against the thief, the false teacher who might come. And they're always coming. They're always coming. They're always coming. Many have been lost to this congregation through false teachers. Maybe you don't know it. Maybe only the elders know it. Maybe they sometimes don't even know it, because they leave and they don't tell you, and they won't tell you. They'll tell you everything but the real reason they've left. But let me read to you from John chapter 10. I begin at verse 4. And when he put forth his own sheep, he goeth before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. And a stranger will they not follow if they're his sheep, but will flee from him, for they know not the voice of strangers. But there are many who come, who call the sheep, and the sheep will not follow them. And when they do, they discover perhaps they were never sheep. A watchman stands on the walls to warn the city of approaching enemies, of approaching danger. So the elders are to warn the people with great earnestness about their danger, lest their blood be upon the watchman's hands. I read to you Acts chapter 20. I go back to that 20th chapter, and I look at verse with you, the verse 18 and following. When they come to him, they said unto him, ye know how from the first day, Paul said this to them, ye know how from the first day I came into Asia, after what manner I had been with you at all seasons. It's not Thomas More, a man for all seasons. That's Paul, a man for all, true man for all seasons. Serving the Lord with all humility of mind, and with many tears and temptations which befell me by the lying in wait of the Jews, and how I kept back nothing that was profitable for you, but showed unto you and taught you publicly and from house to house, testifying both to the Jew and also to the Greek, repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. And now I go bound in the Spirit unto Jerusalem. These were not literal fetters, but they would come later, the fetters, the chains would come later. But he goes bound by God's chains upon obedience to him and submission to God, to Jerusalem, not knowing the things that shall befall me. And then he warns them. Many will sneak in. Many will come among you and betray your trust. Some among your own numbers, some who were elders at that time in Ephesus, are false elders and will lead the sheep away from the shepherd, Jesus Christ. That's what he's saying. I didn't say it. Paul said it, an infallible writer of Scripture. But they watch for your souls. Maybe I should read Ezekiel chapter 3 and verse 17 and following. Son of man, I have made thee a watchman unto the house of Israel. Therefore, hear the word of my mouth at my mouth, and give them warning from me when I say unto the wicked, thou shalt surely die, and thou givest him not warning, nor speakest to warn the wicked from his wicked way to save his life. The same wicked man shall die in his iniquity, but his blood will I require at your hands. Yet if thou warn the wicked, and he turn not from his wickedness, nor from his wicked way, he shall die in his iniquity, but thou hast delivered thy soul. He goes on to speak a little more about these watchmen. Paul seems to go back, or at least the writer of Hebrews seems to go back, to this figure of speech of watchmen looking out for the souls of the sheep of the church. Now, the soul is to be tended to tirelessly. But what is the soul? Stands for the whole man, but especially for the inward and spiritual part of the man. But the entirety of the person is involved in this word soul, not just something spiritual and ephemeral. It's your body as well. Even though we sometimes divide body and soul, we should not. So when those who have the rule over you do not tirelessly care for your souls, that power becomes harmful to them and ruinous to the church, to you, the church. We should yield obedience and submission when elders are tirelessly caring for our souls. When we see them deeply concerned for us, for our spiritual warfare, and welfare, we should be thankful we have such shepherds and give God the praise and give them the thanks. Yes, maybe sometimes it isn't pleasant if you're like a straying sheep and have gone away and they're calling you back. It may not be so easy, maybe very difficult for you to listen. But they are calling you because they love you and care for you and for your eternal souls, body and soul as well. So you should willingly, cheerfully, even lovingly submit. Yes, joyfully submit, obey their lawful directions. But there's another part of the reason or motive that will help us to persuade us to obey and honor the rulers and submit to them. Let me read it to you. Obey them that have the rule over you, submitting yourselves, for they watch for your souls as they that must give an account, that they may do so with joy and not with grief, for that is unprofitable for you. Those who have the rule must give an account for our souls. They rule over us and must give an account. A reckoning is coming for our souls on their account. Now they're accountable to another, not to you. First of all, they're accountable to God. They're not the owners of the sheep. They're the stewards of the sheep. They're the shepherds of the sheep, even the under-shepherds of the sheep. So they do not lord it over the flock, but serve. They are servants of the one who owns the sheep. He himself is the owner. God himself is the owner. So all men must give to God an account for themselves. You must do that for yourself. Whether you've been faithful or slothful. But the rulers must turn in an account not only for themselves and their own souls, but for all the souls of the flock over which they have the oversight. Don't you see what responsibility is theirs? What an awesome, terrible, in some ways, responsibility rests on their shoulders. Do you love them for taking on such responsibility? I hope you've learned to love them. For we do feel sometimes like Paul, who is sufficient for these things? No human being is really sufficient for these things. Now the unfaithful watchman shall perish with his hearers. He didn't warn them. He wasn't faithful. Their blood will be on the blood of the hearers will be on their hands as the leaders, as the rulers, as the heads over the flock. That's why your preacher preaches like he does, earnestly, and doesn't cut off corners. You see, Paul didn't spare that. He told them the whole counsel, all the counsel of God, everything that was necessary for them to know. He did not keep back anything. He told them squarely, clearly. And sometimes you bump into those corners and it hurts. Hit your head on this, it'll hurt. But it's there. And the Word of God sometimes is like these sharp corners. And the real pastor, the real minister, the real shepherd, the real ruling elders too, do not cut off those square corners where God put them. You must watch. They must watch. Our shepherds are accountable to God for us. Therefore, obey and submit to them. This is a constant and a daily accountability. But it is also a final accountability at the last day when there will be the day of reckoning, the ultimate day, the final day of reckoning. Nothing is greater in life and in death to the elders than their accountability for their watchful care for the souls of the flock. Obey, submit, that they, the rulers, may give an account with joy and not with grief. For that is unprofitable for you. So this accountability either brings joy to the rulers, to the shepherds, under shepherds, or it brings grief when they're disregarded and they go on and leave the Lord. And these Christians in the Hebrew church were in a dangerous place. To turn away was their danger. And these faithful rulers are warning them. So those who obey and honor those who have the rule over them are the greatest joy to the elders, to the leaders, to the rulers. I will read you a few places. I'll only read you a few, but it's all there. In the third chapter, in the third John and the verse 4, we read, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. What is the great joy of the ruler of that church? That the children walk in truth. And then I read to you from 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. The verse is 19. For what is our hope or joy or crown of rejoicing? Are not even ye in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ at his coming? For ye are our glory and our joy. Maybe you never thought about it in those terms. I hope you will from now on. Now those who do not obey and honor cause the elders to give an account with what? With grief and sorrow. The rebellious and the wandering sheep are the greatest grief and sorrow to their elders, to their shepherds. Those who do not follow and honor caring and watchful guides cause those guides to grieve, and they work to their own disadvantage, even to their own eternal destruction, except they repent. How is this, you ask? You lose what? What is your disadvantage? You lose the benefit of the watchful care and the prayers and the preaching and the teaching and the visits and the discipline of your elders. You lose that advantage because you disregard it. It's not by constraint, but by example that they lead you. But when you do not follow them and you do not let them lead you and guide you, it's unprofitable for you. You lose all the benefit of their watching care and prayers and teaching and visits and discipline. You grieve their hearts and turn them to discouragement. They've lost sleep. I don't think you know this. But they've lost sleep. Not only shed their tears, maybe sometimes even in your presence. But sleepless nights have been spent for you who wander away from the Lord. Let us therefore, says Calvin, remember that we are paying the penalty of our own obstinacy whenever our pastors grow lax in their duties or are less diligent than they ought to be. A sad thing. So you lose the advantage of watching careful shepherds who also lose their joy. For the servant has no greater joy than that the sheep should follow the Lord. And you provoke God. You provoke Him to take away the shepherd who cares for your souls. And you eventually, if you continue to refuse to listen and to heed and to watch to the watchman, forfeit your salvation and bring eternal damnation upon your soul except you repent. You repent not to the under shepherd, but to the chief shepherd, the Lord Jesus Christ. But there is still hope for you. No matter how far you may have gone from the Lord, look now to Jesus Christ. Turn to the Lord Jesus Christ. Repent before God and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and yield obedience and honor to those to whom honor and obedience is due, even the rulers of His people who watch over you. They tirelessly care for your souls, and they must daily and eternally give an account to God for you. How joyful they will be before God, and how profitable it will be for you if you listen. Do it for the glory of God and the joy of your minister and elders, and to the advantage of your own soul, and to the purity and peace of the whole entire church. It is a wonderful thing that we have here. No one can do it except the Lord give grace and strengthen and enable you in faith to turn to the Lord first of all, and then to listen to His rulers in the church. And the benefits are enormous to everyone, including the church. Yourself as well. Let us stand. Father, we cannot, but we must yield such loving obedience and give such respect and submission. But it is profitable for us, and it is the joy of our shepherds, of the elders. And it is for the benefit and good of the whole church, profitable for each one, but for the entire body. But only by the Lord Jesus Christ, only through him can we make such a decision and do such a thing and give such obedience and submission. Grant that we might see Christ. In loving him, may we love his shepherds and give them their lawful and rightful due of obedience as they continually, constantly lead us with that giving of an account for every one of us to the Lord himself. But only by the Lord himself will we be able. But by his grace, we will, though imperfectly, love and serve, obey and submit to the shepherds, the rulers. Grant it, O God, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us sing together. The psalm is number 92, 12 through 15. Psalm 92 and the verses 12 through 15. The tune is Contemplation, number 44. The words are those of Psalm 22, beginning at the 12th verse. And old age, when others fade, their fruit shall still forth bring. They shall be fat and full of sap, and be flourishing. To show that upright is the Lord, he is a rock to me, and he from all unrighteousness is altogether free.
Love.
stand and receive God's benediction. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.